Christian Audio presents Suffering is Never for Nothing by Elisabeth Elliot. Narrated by Pam Ward, a member of SAG-AFTRA. Publisher's Preface. Elisabeth Elliot died on June 15, 2015, at her home in Magnolia, Massachusetts. At the time of her death, she had suffered dementia for many years and was undoubtedly ready to go be with the Savior of whom she taught so many, so faithfully. I know that she did this because she taught me. I didn't have the opportunity to meet her until late in her life, when dementia had already stolen her voice. But her words will always be seared in my heart and mind. Hear the call of God to be a woman. Obey that call. Turn your energies to service. Whether your service is to be to a husband and through him and the family and home God gives you to serve the world, or whether you should remain in the providence of God, single, in order to serve the world without the solace of husband, home, and family, you will know fullness of life, fullness of liberty, and, I know whereof I speak, fullness of joy. That quote from Let Me Be a Woman is one of hundreds that have challenged, encouraged, frustrated, and led me in my walk with God. Having not grown up in the church, I didn't learn of Elisabeth Elliot until she was already in declining health and had stopped publishing and recording her radio program. I was first exposed to her ministry in Through Gates of Splendor, and I was quickly hooked on her writing. Years later, as a publisher, I met a close friend of Elizabeth's. This friend had been discipled by Elizabeth for several years, and a deep friendship had developed prior to her illness. This friend knew that I had been shaped by her books and had consumed all the teaching content I could find. So she sent me a gift that has borne much fruit. It was a set of 6 CDs that were called Suffering is Not for Nothing. I listened to these CDs and was amazed. Not only was it, I thought, perhaps her best content ever, it was some of the best teaching content I'd ever heard from anyone. I was able to get some additional copies of the CDs, which I gave to several close friends as gifts, and they all raved about the influence of the content on their lives as well. Years went by, and I never stopped thinking about the clarity of the teaching on suffering that I had heard on those CDs. I just knew that the content would make an incredible book. Then, in 2012, I had the opportunity to travel with our mutual friend who had given me the CDs, Elizabeth and her husband, Lars Grin, to some events in Texas. Elizabeth was in poor health and unable to communicate verbally, but there would be moments in which I could see the clarity of those piercing blue eyes connect with mine. She would grip my hand, try to speak, and I knew that she was in there understanding. I told her how God had used her in my life and in the lives of hundreds of thousands of young women who would never have the privilege to tell her, as I was then. At one point, I found myself filled with anger toward God as I watched her struggle, trying to communicate. I couldn't understand how he would allow this incredible woman who had given him so much to suffer in this way. And then I heard her voice in my head say, "The cross is the gateway to joy." And was there any greater suffering than on the cross? I realized that the suffering I was observing was in no way inconsistent with the message she taught her entire life. She suffered much, and she always taught us through it. She finished well because she lived well. It will be more than 6 years after that trip with her and nearly 4 years after her death when this book is published. It is a very slight adaptation of that set of CDs that I received many years ago, never before published in book form. This material was originally delivered by Elizabeth at a small conference over the course of 6 sessions. I have edited only the content which will allow you, as a listener, to not be distracted by references to sessions, yesterday's lesson, or things such as temporal references that have now shifted. It has been my effort to retain the distinct, clear voice of a woman and a writer. It is my prayer that this book will reintroduce the work of Elisabeth Elliot to a new generation, while continuing to deepen the seeds she has already planted for so many of us. Finally, rereading this, I feel she would not appreciate all this adoration for her. So I must acknowledge that Elisabeth Elliot, although gifted and faithful, was a woman like any other. She was imperfect, a sinner, and was quick to admit it. What was extraordinary about her was the light of Christ that showed through all the cracks created in her by the extraordinary experiences she suffered. But it was never for nothing. Jennifer Lyle, October 2018. Foreword. For centuries, we've heard that the blood of martyrs is the seed of the church, and the blood of Jim Elliot certainly overflowed the inkwells into which Elizabeth dipped her pen. She gave us invigorating martyr words that inspired generations of courageous missionaries to take the gospel into foreboding jungles, deserts, and cities great and small. She also gave those same words to inspire us, especially when suffering hit us broadside. I was first introduced to Elisabeth Elliot in 1965, when, in high school, I read her book Through Gates of Splendor. I had no idea that right after graduation and a diving accident, I would enter those dark valleys about which Elisabeth wrote. I then met her years later in 1976, when we were both speakers at a conference in Canada. I was only 26, with less than a decade under my belt as a quadriplegic, and I could hardly believe I was sharing the same plenary platform with this saint of the age. One evening, she came to my hotel room. As Elizabeth sat on the edge of my bed, we opened our hearts and shared how God had remained so faithful to us through so much suffering. We agreed that no one participates in God's joy without first tasting the afflictions of his Son. And before she left, she smiled and said, "Suffering is never for nothing, Joni." It was so Elizabethan, and I thought I understood what she meant. After all, 9 years of quadriplegia had made me take seriously the lordship of Christ in my life, refining my faith and giving me a deeper interest in prayer and the Word. 2 years later, I even wrote about these things in a book. I was pleased with my list of the 35 good biblical reasons as to why God allows affliction and what you can learn from it. I asked Elizabeth if she would offer an endorsement, which she did. But in her cover letter, she confessed that although the book was very satisfactory, it was a bit technical. Her comment crushed me. It took a few more years of quadriplegia and the encroachment of chronic pain to help me see there was more, much more, to suffering than learning its theological background and benefits. Elizabeth Elliot knew that true maturity, joy, and contentment has less to do with a mechanistic assessment of God's plan and more to do with being pushed and, at times, shoved against the breast of your Savior. Not a tidy, orderly list, but an earnest grappling with the angel of the Lord. When affliction decimates you, then you understand Elizabeth's doctrine. The Bible's answers are never to be separated from the God of the Bible. That rich truth then guided me through more than 50 years of paralysis, pain, and cancer. We are invigorated by Elizabeth's no-nonsense, go-out-and-die way of living the Christian life. She made us see that we are on a fierce battlefield, upon which the mightiest forces of the universe converge in warfare. And we happily rise to that challenge, totally energized by this remarkable woman's exalted vision for the church. Her life and writings are food and drink to those whom God places upon altars of affliction. And now, with Suffering is Never for Nothing, we have another collection of fresh, insightful writings from which to be nourished. Thankfully, although our friend is now in heaven, more of her material is now available to spur us on in the battle. The book you are listening to is a wonderful new portfolio of Elisabeth's ponderings. And as you listen to each chapter, imagine Elisabeth listening with you from the grandstands of heaven, encouraging you to embrace the Lord Jesus in your afflictions. Let our friend show you how suffering is never for nothing. Linger long on this woman's sage wisdom, for there are epiphanies yet to dawn on your horizon, showing you even brighter excellencies of Jesus and more astounding beauties of his gospel. Let the timeless truths in this brand new book spur you on. Take to heart her words, and one day when together we pass through heaven's gates, they will indeed be splendorous. Jody Erickson Tada, Jody and Friends International Disability Center, Spring 2019. Chapter 1. The Terrible Truth. When I was told that my first husband, Jim, was missing in Alca, Indian country, the Lord brought to my mind some words from the prophet Isaiah. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers they shall not overflow thee. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 2. I prayed silently, Lord, let not the waters overflow. And he heard me, and he answered me. 2 years later, I went to live with the Indians who had killed Jim. 16 years after that, after I had come back to the States, I married a theologian named Addison Leach. He died of cancer 3.5 years later. There have been some hard things in my life, of course, as there have been in yours, and I cannot say to you I know exactly what you're going through. But I can say that I know the one who knows. And I've come to see that it's through the deepest suffering that God has taught me the deepest lessons. And if we'll trust him for it, we can come through to the unshakable assurance that he's in charge. He has a loving purpose, and he can transform something terrible into something wonderful. Suffering is never for nothing. When C.S. Lewis was asked to write a book on the problem of pain, he asked permission to write it anonymously. Permission was denied as not being in keeping with that particular series, and this is what he wrote in his preface. If I were to say what I really thought about pain, I should be forced to make statements of such apparent fortitude that they would become ridiculous if anyone knew who made them. I echo those sentiments. When I hear other people's stories about their own sufferings, I feel as though I know practically nothing about the subject myself. I'm in kindergarten, as it were, compared to, for example, my friend Jan, who is a quadriplegic and lies on one side or the other 24 hours a day in a nursing home in Connecticut. Or my friend Judy Squires in California, who was born with no legs. Or my late friend Joe Bailey, who lost 3 children. But if all I knew about suffering was by observation alone, it would still be sufficient to tell me that we're up against a tremendous mystery. Suffering is a mystery that none of us is really capable of plumbing, and it's a mystery about which I'm sure everyone, at some time or other, has asked why. If we try to put together the mystery of suffering with a Christian idea of a God who we know loves us, if we think about it for as much as 5 minutes, the notion of a loving God cannot possibly be deduced from the evidence that we see around us, let alone from human experience. I'd like to go back to some of my own home training. I grew up in a very strong Christian home in Philadelphia, where both of my parents were what I call 7-day-a-week kind of Christians. We had a little brass plate over the front doorbell that said, "Christ is the head of this home, the unseen guest at every meal, the silent listener to every conversation." We were taught that God is love. I suppose one of the earliest hymns we were taught was that little gospel song, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." When I was 9 years old, I lived in a neighborhood of 42 boys. But I had a friend who lived about 6 blocks away whose name was Essie. And Essie and I were both 9 years old when she died. When I was probably 3 or 4 years old, we had a guest in our home who was on her way to China as a missionary. Her name was Betty Scott. She went to China and married her fiancé, John Stamm. A few years later, I'm not sure just how old I was, maybe 6 or 7, my father came home one evening with a newspaper telling that John and Betty Stamm had been captured by Chinese communists, marched almost naked through the streets of a Chinese village, and had then been beheaded. You can imagine the impression this made on the mind of a young child, in view of the fact that Betty Stamm had sat at our supper table and had given us her testimony as she was on her way to China. I also remember very vividly the newspaper stories of the kidnapping of Charles Lindbergh's baby, and I would go to sleep at night imagining that I saw a ladder coming up by my window. And my parents, not knowing that I was concerned in this way, didn't think to tell me that there wasn't really a whole lot of danger that anybody was going to be interested in kidnapping a child like me, because we were not really what you might call rich. Nevertheless, I did have some experience of death as a small child. And just a few weeks ago, to bring it more up to date, some friends of my husband's and mine called to say that their little 4-year-old child, who was born with spina bifida, was doing very well. But the mother was pregnant, and for various reasons, had had some tests which had revealed that the child she's now carrying also has spina bifida. And so they were calling just to say, "We're hurting. Please pray for us." And when I hear stories like that, it's what makes me think that my own experience of suffering is really very little. The question is unavoidable for a thinking person. Where is God in all of this? Can you look at the data and believe? And it's the question that was put to Alyosha by Ivan Karamazov in Dostoevsky's famous novel, The Brothers Karamazov, recounting the story of a little girl of 5. Ivan said to his brother, Alyosha, "These educated parents subjected the poor 5-year-old girl to every possible torture. They beat her, flogged her, kicked her, not knowing why themselves, until her whole body was nothing but bruises. All night in the outhouse because she wouldn't ask to get up and go in the middle of the night. As if a 5-year-old child sleeping its sound angelic sleep could have learned to ask by that age. For that they smeared her face with her excrement and made her eat the excrement. And it was her mother who made her. And this mother could sleep while her poor child was moaning all night in that vile place." Can you understand that a small creature who cannot even comprehend what is being done to her in a vile place, in the dark and the cold, beats herself on her strained little chest with her tiny fist and weeps with her anguished, gentle, meek tears for dear God to protect her? Can you understand such nonsense, my friend and my brother, my godly and humble novice? Can you understand why this nonsense is needed and created? And therefore I hasten to return my ticket. And it is my duty, if only as an honest man, to return it as far ahead of time as possible, which is what I am doing. It's not that I don't accept God, Alyosha. I just most respectfully return him the ticket. Tell me straight out, I call on you. Answer me. Imagine that you yourself are building the edifice of human destiny with the object of making people happy in the finale, of giving them peace and rest at last. But for that you must inevitably and unavoidably torture just one tiny creature, that same child who was beating her chest with her little fist, and raise your edifice on the foundation of her unrequited tears. Would you agree to be the architect on such conditions? Tell me the truth. And what I want to share with you is what I see to be the straight truth, with no evasions and no clear, flat platitudes. It's very fresh in my mind, just this week, a picture that I saw in Time magazine of an inconsolable newborn baby whose mother was on crack cocaine. Just to look at that picture brought down on my own head, as it were, everything I was planning to say to you in this series. I happened to be sitting on the plane yesterday next to a woman who was reading a book called Master of Life Manual, which, according to the cover, was about metaphysics, brain-mind awareness, human potential principles, and this stunning statement: create your own reality now. And I thought, I would hate to be down to such an extreme that I had to create my own reality in the face of the data of human experience. So I would ask the question, is there a reason to believe that suffering is not for nothing? Is there an eternal and perfectly loving purpose behind it all? If there is, it's not obvious. It doesn't exactly meet the eye. Yet if for thousands of years, in the face of these stunning realities, this terrible truth, people have believed that there is a loving God, and that God is looking down on the realities around us and still loves us, if these people have still continued to insist that God knows what he's doing, that he's got the whole world in his hands, then I repeat, the reason cannot possibly be obvious. It can't be because those thousands of people were all deaf, dumb, blind, or stupid, and incapable of looking clearly and steadily at the data that you and I are constantly having to look at. What is the answer? F.W.H. Myers, in his poem St. Paul, wrote these words: "Is there not wrong too bitter for atoning? What are these desperate and hidden years? Hast thou not heard thy whole creation groaning, sighs of the bondsman and of woman's tears?" The answer is not obvious. There must be an explanation somewhere. And it's my purpose to try to get at the explanation, and then to see if there's something that you and I can do about this question of suffering. I'm convinced that there are a good many things in this life that we really can't do anything about, but that God wants us to do something with. And I hope that by the time I'm finished, I will have made myself clear. Now, the word suffering may seem very high-flowing and perhaps much too dignified for our particular set of troubles today. And I can look around this audience to whom I'm teaching this content, and I don't know a person here. I have no idea who might receive this content later on in some other form. But if I knew you, and if I knew your stories, then I would know that I can't possibly speak personally to every need that's here, to every kind of suffering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.